So a lot has happened these past few days that we are still trying to wrap our minds around and process, but we just wanted you to know that our leadership teams here at Grace and Providence, that we're doing all that we can to make the best possible decisions regarding what is best for us as congregations moving forward now in this time and place. We realize that so much what we do in congregations is communal in our life together. But upon the recommendation of the Johnson Memorial Health Service Infection Control Team, as they have been receiving recommendations from the Minnesota Department of Health, we have made the decision not to be gathering for in-person worship services at both Grace Lutheran Church and Providence Valley Lutheran Church beginning today, March 15th, and we'll continue to make that decision week by week. But this also includes our Lenten services as well as our Sunday services. So during this time, we will continue to worship together. We will broadcast our worship live at this time, 8:30, our Sunday morning worship at 8:30 on KQ92.1 FM radio. We'll also broadcast our Wednesday evening Lenten worship services at 8 p.m. on Wednesdays through the season of Lent. And then we're also, our worship will be posted on social media, and also, as we have always been doing, our worship will be on Channel 8, the local television access station. So we'll continue to make other decisions on our gatherings on a week-by-week basis. As of now, Sunday and Monday, all of our church activities will be canceled, but our office at Grace Lutheran will remain open. So we are canceling some things, our in-person worship, but we are not canceling worship. It will just look differently. We will continue to share our worship with you. There are some other things that we're not canceling as well. We're not canceling our kindness to one another. We're not canceling our love for one another. We're not canceling our joy that we have with one another, and we're not canceling reaching out to each other with the compassion of Christ, and we are definitely not canceling God's presence in our midst in this time. Now, we understand that there might be some people who are homebound or isolated for a period of time, so we would like to help with their shopping or their running of errands in order for them to limit their risk of being exposed, or even if you're not comfortable going out until we know more, we're just going to ask that you please call the church office here at Grace, 320-769-4394, and we will help you get groceries, we'll help you get your necessities or run errands for you. So please don't hesitate to contact us. We'll have volunteers that will be willing and ready to help you. And we will continue to update the community as our leadership teams work with local health officials to decide the next steps in the best interest of all of our members. The health and safety of all of our members and friends is of utmost priority. So this decision to limit our person-to-person contact is not an act of panic, it is not an act of fear, but it is an act of care. It is a decision that is based on our faith and facts of what we know about this virus. So we feel that it is important to be concerned about the welfare of those who are elderly. We feel that it's important to be concerned about those in frail health among us. And we also know that it is important and it is full of care to worship together. But we feel that we can do both, at least for a time in safe ways, until we have a better handle on limiting the potential spread of this virus. We also acknowledge that many may be experiencing stress and increased anxiety in this time. But we as a faith community wish to help calm some of that worry. That's why we want to make sure that our worship services are broadcast. And so we're here at Grace with some friends of Grace to lead us in our worship this morning. It would be easy to isolate oneself, so it's important that we reach out to each other. So if you have an elderly neighbor, if you have a friend with other health-related issues, or you know someone who is in the high-risk group for infection, we ask that you reach out to them, that you call on them, that you volunteer yourself to pick up their groceries or years. So we're suggesting that each of us contact 5 people in the coming days to reach out to them so that we might grant them some encouragement and help. So pick up the phone and call someone who is alone and isolated at this time and offer a prayer. Offer words of comfort and support to them. And of course, we can love our neighbors by washing our hands. And as we wash our hands, we can say the Lord's Prayer together. That takes about 20 seconds. Did you know that? Or we can say the Creed together. That also takes about 20 seconds. So we help our neighbors by washing our hands. We help our neighbors. We love our neighbors by staying at home if we are sick. We love our neighbors by praying for our frontline people who are working with those who are sick, people in our healthcare industry. So if you're a member of a congregation that has suspended their worship services in order to lower the curve of this virus, we want you to please remember your offerings to your local congregations. Your support and your tithes are important so your church can continue to do the excellent work of caregiving and proclaiming the gospel in this important time. We at Grace have placed resources on our webpage for electronic giving, so if you need to stay current or make up any contributions, those are available for you. Now, the Bible reminds people that whenever people face difficulty and change or struggle to rise above their fears, God's promises remain certain and sure. And so God is a power to turn to in faith. And this is what the psalmist addresses when he wrote, "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change." Well, the earth has changed for us, and it is changing rapidly for us. Whether or not the earth changes for good depends on where we go for refuge and strength. If we believe, as the psalmist declares, that God is our refuge and strength, then God is present whether we worship in person or whether we worship in our homes. We still worship in the Spirit. So let us now together worship the Lord. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who is present, who gives life, who calls into existence the things that do not exist.
Amen. Amen.
If you were to keep watch over sins, O Lord, who could stand? Yet with you is forgiveness, and so we confess. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned away from you, knowingly and unknowingly. We have wandered from your resurrection life. We have strayed from your love for all people. Turn us back to you, O God. Give us new hearts and right spirits, that we may find what is pleasing to you and dwell in your house forever. Receive now the good news. God turns to you in love. I will put my Spirit in you, and you shall live, says our God. All your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ, who is the free and abounding gift of God's grace for you. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
And we sing together our hymn, Jesus, the Very Thought.
Thank you.
First lesson this morning is from Genesis, the 12th chapter. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I'll make of you a great nation, and I will bless you, and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm of the day is Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time on and forevermore. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 4th chapter. What then are we to say was gained by Abraham, our ancestor, according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now to one who works, wages are not reckoned as a gift, but as something due. But to one who without works trusts him who justifies the ungodly, such faith is reckoned as righteousness. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham, or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. It is the adherence of the law who are to be the heirs. Faith is null, and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the gospel acclamation.
Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very tell you. We speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I had told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
God so loved the world. What does that love look like? Sometimes, love looks like receiving Nicodemus in the cover of night to teach the religious elite about spiritual birth. God so loved the world. Sometimes, love looks like taking on extraordinary measures, like putting on flesh and coming into the world, not to condemn it, but to save it. God so loved the world. Sometimes, love looks like journeying from Judea north to Galilee and choosing the quicker but unfavorable route to make a stop in Samaria. God so loved the world. That's exactly what Jesus did as he left Judea shortly after his visit with Nicodemus to travel north to Galilee. Now everyone knew that Jews and Samaritans did not get along. It was a holdover from when the northern kingdom was captured by the Assyrians. The people of the north blended their families and their religious traditions with the Assyrians. So Jews and Samaritans worshipped on different mountains and avoided one another at all costs. So most Jews would take the longer route and bypass Samaria. But not Jesus. He went right through. And though Jesus' route is the most expedient way to get to Galilee, the journey is tiring. So Jesus decides to take a rest by the well, Jacob's well, to be exact. His disciples go on into the nearby town to pick up some lunch. But Jesus sits in the midday sun and surveys the world that he loves so much. He sees a woman approaching the well. She walks slowly and carries a water jug. He notices that she is alone, which is a bit strange, even in Samaria. She sets her jug down by the well and wipes her brow. She turns away from him, clearly wanting to avoid any engagement, but he sees her clearly. He knows her and the pain she feels. "Could I get a drink?" he asks, hoping she would turn around and see the love in his eyes. She doesn't turn. Instead, she picks up her water jug and peers into it. She seems to be considering returning home without filling it. But it needs to be filled, and filled now when all the other women are busy at home. She can't bear the thought of having to draw water with them and their judgmental remarks. None of them have endured what she has. 5 marriages that have all ended in death or divorce. None of the endings were her choosing, and none of them left her the gift of a son. So much love and loss has left her bare. And that's why she comes at this hour in the heat of the day, so that she can do her work in peace. And now this man, a Jew, has the audacity to ask her for a drink of water. He hasn't asked again, but he's clearly waiting for a response. How is it that you, a Jew would ask me for a drink, don't you know that I am a Samaritan? And she says, oh, if only I'd known then what I know now, I wouldn't have asked such a question. He just kept looking at me, and I wanted so desperately to be left alone. But he wouldn't let it be. If you knew who I am, you would be asking me for water, and I would give you living water. That's what he told me, living water. What does that mean? I mean, he didn't even have a bucket. How is he going to get water from the well? And I told him so. Sir, I said, where are you going to get this water? You don't have a bucket. It's a long way down to the water source. I figured I'd caught him with that one, and I glanced over to see his defeat. But instead, I saw a twinkle in his eye. He said, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, will not be thirsty again, but those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I give them will become in them a spring of water, gushing up for eternal life. Well, wouldn't that be nice, I thought. If I had a stream within me, I wouldn't have to trek all this way every day at noon to draw water. Give me some of that water, I said out loud, and maybe a little sarcastically. Then, do you know what he said? He told me to go call my husband, me, the woman who has had five marriages, the woman currently living with a brother-in-law, who refuses to follow the Levirate law and marry me properly. The woman who works all day, has no family to speak of, no one to provide for me. I turned back to the well and muttered, I have no husband. It's a truth I could hardly speak. It's a truth too much to bear. I know, the man said, you are telling the truth that you have no husband. I know you have had five, and the one that you are with now is no husband to you. He spoke gently, without judgment, and I turned to him in astonishment. He had to be a prophet if he knew these things about me. And if he was a prophet, I wanted to know the truth about God. For years, my people have been worshiping on Mount Gerizim. But the Jews say that the only place to worship is in Jerusalem. Which one is right? I asked the prophet. And he said, the time is coming. Know that the time is here now when we will worship neither here nor there, but we will worship God in spirit and in truth. Now I wasn't sure what the prophet meant by that, but he said it in such a way I knew I wanted to be part of it. I faced him fully and told him plainly, I know the Messiah is coming, and when he comes, he will proclaim all things to us. I needed this man to know that we shared that hope, that all things will be made well, and that we would indeed worship together in spirit and in truth. I needed him to know that I yearned for that day when I would be free from my burdens and restored to my community. I looked into his eyes that themselves were deep, like the well, and sparkled with joy. And then he said, I am he, the one who is speaking to you. And a smile played on his lips. My heart skipped a beat, and I stared at him. I wanted to believe what he was saying. Every fiber of my being believed that it was true, but why would the Messiah be speaking to me? And then I heard the sound of a man approaching, and I assumed that it was his disciples, and it snapped me out of my astonishment. If what he says is true, I need to tell others. I dropped my water jug and picked up the hem of my robe and ran into town. I had to share the news. The Messiah is here, and he knows me. He knows truth. God so loved the world Sometimes love looks like asking a Samaritan woman for a drink of water. God so loved the world. Sometimes love looks like hearing someone else's truth. God so loved the world. Sometimes love looks like sharing the good news with others. Now these days, love looks a little different for us. As people of God, we're accustomed to expressing and experiencing God's love through worship, gatherings, through meals, through handshakes and hugs. Being together is important to us. Shared space is important to us. We experience the love of God in our communion with one another. But I don't know if you've heard, there's this virus going around. It's reached pandemic status. It has disrupted life as we know it. And in order to minimize its spread and give medical personnel and centers the best fighting chance, we've been asked to practice social distancing. Gatherings with large number of people or gatherings with people who are most vulnerable have been canceled or postponed. Travel bans have been put in place, and we've been asked to limit our face-to-face interactions. As a Christian community, this seems contrary to who we are, but these days, this is what love looks like. At this time, love looks like an empty worship space. We have asked all but a few to stay home and worship through radio or live streaming today because we love and we care for one another, especially those in our community who are most vulnerable. At this time, love looks like canceling plans, and as disappointing and disrupting as that can be, choosing to not make a trip or go to an event might very well be freeing up resources for others that need them. At this time, love looks like physically distancing ourselves from one another, and in doing so, we limit the possibility of exposure and save lives. These are strange times, and strange times call for different ways of loving. Notice that I said different ways of loving. During this strange time, we do not stop loving one another. Pastor Kendall included in the announcements this morning, we do not cancel love. We simply find other ways to share that love with others, especially with those who social distancing leads to loneliness and isolation. So let's find a way to mind the physical gap while closing our spiritual one. Again, as was mentioned in the announcements, each week with our Lenten study, The Walk, we have been challenged to do five things individually. The first week, it was to pray five times a day. The second week, to read five verses of Scripture a day. And this past week, to do five acts of kindness. And we're to look at our hand and the five fingers on our hand to remember those five things. So we will continue to build on these challenges in the coming weeks with giving and sharing during our Wednesday Lenten services. But it seems appropriate that today, as we worship together over the radio and the internet, that we look at our hands and think of five people to check in with. Call, text, or send a message to five people in the coming days. Ask how they're doing. See if they need anything, and offer to pray together. It seems to me that this would be just one way we can help one another feel close and connected in this time of social distancing. Now, this week, I've been thinking about how the woman at the well had experienced social distancing herself. I suspect that some of that had been forced upon her by her culture. And some opposed. And yet Jesus came to her and closed the gap with truth. He heard her truth and spoke truth back to her with kindness, in love. And she was changed because of it. Her trip to the well was greatly disrupted by this encounter with love. She went to the well to complete a necessary chore. She went expecting to draw water and to make the hot, dusty walk back home. She went expecting no one else would be around in the middle of the day, and she would complete her task in peace. But once she encountered Jesus the Messiah, she dropped her water jug and ran off. We don't know that her water jug was ever filled with water from that well. But we do know that she was filled with living water, with the Spirit, and with truth. She rushed back to town to tell others that the Messiah is here. The spring of living water given to her was bubbling up and over. And many believed because of what she said. They sought their own encounter with Jesus, the Messiah. They ran out to the well and invited him to stay in the Samaritan town so that they too might have a well within them. People of God, sometimes, maybe at this very time, love looks like an empty jug of water abandoned at a well.